everybody. Welcome. Thank you for coming. We know that there's many other things you could probably be doing with your evening, so we appreciate you coming out tonight to be part of this community meeting. My name is Gail Gramarosa, and I work with the Collaborative for Educational Services. One of my colleagues is here. I'd like her to say hello and introduce herself as well.
I'm Catherine Brooks, also with the Collaborative for Educational Services. It used to be called the Hampshire Educational Collaborative, or HEC, so people still call us that.
Thank you. We have been working with Dr. Provost and the schools to take a look at helping to facilitate part of this meeting tonight, and as well as next week. There'll be a similar meeting held. So we will be involved with some discussion after the presentation. Dr. Provost is going to walk us through the QSORT process, what was learned, what some of the findings were. You'll have an opportunity to ask questions about that. And then Catherine and I will be looking to probably split the number, based on the number of folks here, we'll probably split you into two smaller groups and just get your thoughts, reactions. We have some questions, open-ended questions that we'd like to pose to you. We'll be taking some notes again for tonight's meeting as well as next week's meeting, and then kind of summarizing everything and sharing that back with the school district. So again, we really appreciate you coming. You'll see lots of information on Dr. Provost's slides, and then again, we'll have some conversation about it. And also you'll hear what the next steps are, where we are, where the school district is in this process, what it means to them, and where things may go in the next steps. So let me turn things over. It's my pleasure. I'm sure that many of you know Dr. John Provost, the superintendent here. I will turn things over to him, and he will walk you through his presentation. Feel free to move. We are being filmed here, but if just to be sure that you can see the slides, feel free to adjust your seating as well, and I'll just kind of duck around this side.
Okay, great. Thank you. This isn't my usual computer, so I'll be kind of working back and forth. Hopefully this works. Okay, so this was in Excel, and I'm looking at it right now through Google Docs, so some of the formatting may be off. But I just wanted to talk a little bit about the process that led to the QSORT. These three works you can find on the district website. Some people refer to them as the trilogy. they were the entry findings when I came to Northampton 2.5, getting close to 3 years ago now, which is the first document presented to the school committee in February of 2015. The entry findings listed a number of the strengths of the district as well as a number of challenges that the district was facing. And then there was a second document that focused just on the challenges, which is called root cause analysis. So we looked at the challenges we had identified in Northampton and tried to say, okay, so if those are symptoms of some problems the district is facing, what's the root cause? Because we want to put our energy into working on root causes instead of trying to treat symptoms, because, you know, the energy you put into symptom treatment is not very effective. In the end, new problems keep arising. So, and then the third document in the series is the District Improvement Plan for the Northampton Public Schools. That started with the 7 root causes we had found for some of the problems in the district. And we met in this very room. There was a group of about 30 community members, teachers, administrators, some parents, and some people who are just concerned about the schools. And we asked them each to take the root causes and then to develop strategies to work on the root causes. So one of the root causes that we found for problems within the district was unclarity, or lack of clarity, I guess I should say, with what the district really stands for. What are the most important values? Because when you look through the documents, at least for me as an outsider at the time, it looks like a lot of what was under discussion in the district was contested ground without a firm foundation of, okay, this is what we believe in, to use it as sort of the lens for determining whether a decision was correct or incorrect. And so the group that was working on that root cause said, we need to figure out what our values as a district are. And through discussion, actually, I think Lori, if Farkas is here tonight, was actually in charge of that that group. They landed on the Q-sort as the way. Oh, that's right. Oh, so we had three members from that group here tonight. It was determined that we would launch a Q-sort to try to figure out what the district's values are. So that process actually started in the open houses in fall of 2015. We had jars at the open houses where we asked people just to respond to the sentence starter, Northampton Public School should help students blank. We received about 300 responses at the six open houses, but the 300 responses broke down into about 22 to 24 things that just kept being repeated over and over again in different ways. And so those became the deck that people sorted later on. I'm going to share with you a little bit later the size of participation. I got to tell you, for a district of 2,700 students, I think the participation in this was overwhelming. It was more than 1,700 individuals actually sorted. So I think anywhere you go with Northampton School people for the next few years, you can ask, did you do the Q-sort? And the majority will say yes. How many in here did the Q-sort? Okay. All right. Good. Okay. So everyone wants to know what happened, you know. So what are the results? That's what we're here to talk about tonight. Okay. So goals for tonight are to help you know what the outcomes were, and really to discuss some plausible interpretations, because we now have a quantitative solution to the sorts, but we have to kind of define what that means in qualitative terms. Okay, so I have a provisional interpretation, but I'd like it either to be, you know, verified by this group and the group who meets next week, or modified or challenged, whatever. We need to reach consensus on what those results mean. Because what we'll be doing next steps is using our values to sort of communicate about what we are as a district. And I'll be asking the school committee to sort of formally adopt those as their values to help guide decisions that they make for the future. So why did we do the Q-sort? You know, we could have done it a bunch of different ways. This actually was part of the discussion in that group that was trying to determine the strategy for finding our goals. You know, we could have done surveys, but there are problems with surveys. Response rates tend to be low. Also, you know, surveys can result in people rating everything high, which really isn't going to be helpful for the district if we're trying to prioritize values. You know, every card that went into that jar was something that somebody thought was a good idea, right? But we can't focus on 300 things, and we can't focus on even 22 or 24 things. We have to focus on a small number of things. And so the Q-sort is better than the survey for that. Focus groups are another method that people sometimes use. This is a kind of a focus group, so it's sort of another method that's checking the results of that first method. But, you know, look at who you have. I didn't think we could have had 1,700 people come to a focus group. And the goal was really to raise all voices. Open meetings, town halls, kind of same issues. There is the opportunity for dialogue, which we'll have tonight, but there is sort of a barrier to participation for a lot of people. So we wanted to have something that had low barriers to participation and resulted in people making sort of rank order choices. So just a few quotes to get things started, why values are important, from works that a lot of educators and others I think will know. First, for the courage to teach, Parker J. Palmer, when we declare our values in a visible and viable way, we will sometimes be amazed at the way allies gather around, and I hope that's what happens for us. And then from another book called Stewardship, Peter Block, let people at every level communicate about what they want to create. That's really what we're trying to do, you know. I've been in education for more than 20 years. I certainly have opinions about what should be valued in education and what shouldn't be valued, but I don't think it's my role as superintendent to impose my values on whatever district I happen to be leading at the time. I think it's my role to help people figure out in their community what they value. And so my hope is that by letting this, which really came out of the community. You know, all 300 statements and all 1,700 sorts were from people who were impacted by organization. So by letting people tell us what their values are, I hope they will be endorsed and supported if we say, yeah, okay, this is what we stand for. Okay. So I think I will, I think I've already talked about this, so I want to save as much time for dialogue as possible. I'll skip over this. Reminding you of what was in the sorts. These were the statements. I'm not going to read them right now, but this is just sort of a reminder since most of you did it. They really were wide-ranging. There were values in here that were sort of contradictory. You know, there were statements like protect kids from too much technology and also help kids become better users of technology. You know, there were things like raise rigor and protect kids from high-pressure testing and, you know, assessments. So there were really a whole potpourri of what was on people's minds, and this is what went into the decks that everybody sorted. Okay, so this is the sample size, 1,756 in the end. We did have a couple of sorts that aren't included in that method because some people broke the rules. Some people said they're all important, so I'm putting them all in number one. We had to discount that data. But we did have a very diverse group of stakeholders. Parents took it, teachers took it, administrators, other school employees, ESPs, I think was probably the biggest group of non-teacher school employees who took it. Students, and the whole sample was sort of the largest group. We had almost 100% participation of students from 5th through 12th grade. So when you're thinking about student data, we do have data from all of the 6 schools, but you need to sort of bear in mind that it's swamped really by data from middle school and high school because they had 7 grades and the elementary only had 1 grade. And we did have other community members. We did this, you know, several dozen times at open houses and science fairs and other things that drew people to the schools. So very happy with the sample we ended up with. This is what a Q-sort looks like, although you know that because most of you have done this. So example, completed Q-sort. The idea is you get a bell-shaped curve in the end because that has special mathematical characteristics that make it amenable to different kinds of statistical analysis. Okay, so how does this stuff get reported? There are a lot of charts I could show you, but this is the one I want to show you because I think it's the one that resonates most with people who may not be so familiar with this technology. This is called a scree plot, and what you're looking at the bottom is what are known as components. In other words, ways of sorting the cards that were present among all the sorts that were received. So you can see this one has 18 components, and the height of the dot shows the amount of variance that's explained by that component. So you can see in this example, that first component is qualitatively different than all the rest of the components. And the rule when you're analyzing this kind of data is you go to the elbow. So in this one, the elbow occurs right after the first component. You can see that one is way up at the top of the graph, and then other ones are accounting for tiny little marginal pieces of the variance, but most of it is one. That's what they call a one-factor solution. And we broke the data down into a number of different groups because you can't have more participants than you have questions, so we have to keep breaking it down. And so in the end, I think we had something like 46 different groups of students. They were all one-factor solutions. We had 24 different groups of parents. They were all one-factor solutions. So you saw this kind of chart coming off of everything, which means that among the groups, they were all sorting them basically the same way. Doesn't mean that everyone was included in factor one. There are people who wouldn't necessarily be factor one identified sorts, but what it means is the ones who weren't in factor one didn't have any characteristic way of sorting their sorts. So they were all individualistic. So that's a really powerful result. I thought.
Can you explain that more? I'm not understanding.
Does it take stats?
So what it means, so what this is looking for is you have 24 cards, you have 24 positions, so there are thousands of different, you know, possible combinations. It's looking for, are there characteristic ways of sorting the cards that different sorters did the same way? And so factor one, you know, just means, okay, so we identified this one pattern of sorting, and we found that that was repeated over and over again by most of the people. There were, factor two would be a different way of sorting, but not many people did it. Factor three would be a different way of sorting, but not significant.
Wait, how do you decide a factor? How do you find a factor?
The computer finds a factor by comparing each sort to every other sort, okay, and seeing if people are putting the cards in the same positions.
Okay.
Does that help?
Kind of.
Okay.
So the factor one sort was the factor that was the order that you saw the most.
That's right.
Across all of the people who were doing this.
That's right.
It's the one that came, and from that chart, it looks like it was a big difference between number one and number two.
Right.
They weren't really even close.
Right. And so what you do when you get a result like this is, the rule is you don't carry any of the other factors forward for analysis. You just go to the elbow and say, okay, that's it. So then you look at, well, what is this factor like? All right, so how are people sorting the cards, and what does that say about what they value? All right, so 29, as I said, parent and staff, we had 29 different groups. Here are the highest rankings, and they were all factor one, one-factor solutions, rather, among all of the 29 groups. So 23 of the 29 had Northampton Public Schools should help students discover their interests and help them reach their potential and develop empathy, kindness, and compassion. That was the top, those two were tied with each other. It's top sorts among parents and staff. Next, 22 of the 29 groups had the next four statements in the top positions: become lifelong learners, respect and appreciate diversity, learn how to learn, develop a love of learning. Then there was one statement that 20 of the groups endorsed: develop confidence. And then we had 19 of them ranking high: develop social skills and improve mental or emotional well-being. 17 of the groups: become aware of matters of global concern and engaged in citizens of their local community. And 16 of the groups were endorsing have hands-on learning experience. We didn't go any further than this because when you get below 16 groups, that's less than half of the groups. So those statements were not, even if they were, say, 14 groups may have had other statements that were high, that doesn't represent a majority of the 29 groups.
Dr. Provost, a group is individuals who had the same sort.
No, a group is, when I said we had to break it down, because you can't have more individuals than cards in the analysis, it's just those groups of 22 people. So this means that we had basically 400, 500 adults, which we had to break down into 22 groups for analysis.
Thank you.
Well, why can you 29. Not have more individuals than cards?
This is a little bit complicated, but the reason is when you're using this methodology as opposed to surveys, where you treat the survey takers as individuals, in this, the questions are actually individuals, and the people who took it become the variables. And so you can't have more variables than individuals. You can't analyze it. So that's what the parent results look like.
And staff.
These are the lowest rankings among parents and staff. So 23 of the 29 groups all had all these statements on the left-hand side: protect them from stress of grades and assessments. So parents and staff did not think that was important. Becoming involved in after school and extracurricular activities, i.e. clubs, intramurals. Avoid substance abuse by improving the school lunch program. Get adequate sleep or participate in athletics and recreation. Now, remember, the directions I gave was you only have so many positions in the top. Something has to go in the bottom. doesn't necessarily mean you think these are negative things or, you know, anti-values. It's just that compared to everything else, it's what you'd put lowest. Then this next one is really ambiguous. This was low in the parents and staff. 22 said, gave a very low ranking to helping them become proficient technology users, and 22 also gave a very low ranking to limiting the overuse of computer technology. So that, I think, is a very ambiguous finding. Maybe it means that there's neither a desire to try to prevent kids from using technology, nor a desire to help them become more proficient at using technology. Not exactly sure, but it's an interesting finding. Right, that could be too. One of the things that a lot of the sorters said when they were making their decisions, I mean, this isn't recorded enough in order to be sort of enter into the analysis, but a lot of people from this group, I remember saying, well, I think this is something that families should do, not necessarily something the school should do. Discriminate between reliable and unreliable information. So this is before the era of fake news. And then the last statement that was sorted low was prevent bullying.
Can I just ask again, how many statements were there to sort?
24, I believe.
24. So these 24.
Would be in the low positions, like the -4 position, -3 position, -2 position. Okay. So this is the part where I need feedback from you. So then the question becomes, how do you characterize those rankings? I think of 3 C's, character, curiosity, and community. So in the character bucket, I've put respecting and appreciating diversity, developing kindness, empathy, and compassion. In the curiosity bucket, discover their interests and become, I mean, help them to reach their potential, become lifelong learners. In the community bucket, just that one statement about developing social skills, becoming aware of matters of global concern, engage citizens of their local community. So I'm going to ask, when we talk, whether you think that's a viable characterization of what was sorted high. Okay. So student rankings. These ones we did by school, because we were able to, it just became a better way to analyze the data. So some differences right away. 6, remember we just said bullying was low for parents and staff, but it was right at the top. All kids from all 6 schools put preventing bullying at the top. Developing social and emotional skills and improve their mental and emotional well-being, that was high in all 6 schools. Having hands-on learning experiences was high in all 6 schools. Then in 5 schools endorsed the next 3 statements: discover their interests and help them reach their potential, develop kindness, empathy, and compassion, and develop confidence. 4 of the schools, students endorsed respecting and appreciating diversity, and in 3 of the schools, developing a love of learning and avoiding substance abuse. So we didn't go beyond that because then you're talking about a minority of schools. But it was also kind of a electoral college method of making sure that a small school was just not excluded. But a lot of similarities, but some differences, right? Bullying's on the mind of kids. Substance abuse is more on the mind of kids. Things to think about. Lowest rank, in 6 of the 6 schools, we got low rankings for after school and extracurricular, limiting the overuse of technology, and discriminating between reliable and unreliable information. That one's really interesting to me. In 4 of the schools, these are low rankings, remember, things that kids were not necessarily, were sort of choosing against: developing a love of learning, being protected from stress of grades and assessment, getting adequate sleep, becoming proficient technology users, participating in co-curricular activities during the day, such as art, music, and technology classes, being challenged by a rigorous curriculum. And then in three of the schools, see this is kind of an interesting split here, avoiding substance abuse, which was also highly chosen in three of the schools, so that's kind of ambiguous. Improving the school lunch program and becoming aware of matters of global concern and engage citizens in their local community.
Do you remember how the substance abuse question broke down by grade level? But like, not grade level, but was it the high school students that were more concerned, or was it the elementary students?
We're going to look at it by grade level next. Okay. So, great question. It's a great segue, actually. But first, so elementary. I didn't include the list because I didn't want to make this presentation too long. But in elementary, there were still all the statements about character. There were all the statements about curiosity. But they also were the ones that had this concern about health. They were the ones who had the concern about substance abuse. They actually wanted extracurricular activities, athletics and recreation. And they had also more statements around emotional well-being. Secondary school rankings, they have the same sort of four categories I would propose, but they have some slightly different things within them. The secondary level, bullying prevention becomes more important. It was mainly junior and high school kids who were concerned about bullying, and they were also concerned with leisure and physical health, but for them it wasn't substance abuse, it was sleep. So, areas of agreement among all groups I would propose are character and curiosity. And so one of the things that I'm wondering is whether we have three C's as values or two C's as values, you know, because the adults and the staff members felt it was important for kids to know about the community. Kids really didn't want to learn about that. Or at least they chose against it in their cards. And so this is one of the questions that I think we grapple with all the time as educators. To what extent do we want to say, we respect your opinion and want to try to help you support you in it, and to what extent do we say, no, we know better, this is important, you should learn about it. That's one of the things for us to discuss.
Yes. Another dumb question. The Q sort, when they sorted them, because I didn't do it, are you saying there was a part where they basically said, I actively do not think this is important, or it was more a ranking of, I got to put this one last because I want these ones first?
So do you remember the picture of what the sort looked like? So there was the middle part where the more cards were was a zero. That was neutral.
Okay.
And so then the instruction was the statements that you were in most agreement with, you put towards the positive side. The statements you were in less agreement with, you put towards the negative side. So it wasn't necessarily that the students thought that it was bad,
right,
as much as they thought that it was not as important as other things. So some of the things that the parents thought were highly important, kids thought were less important, and vice versa.
I'm just asking because it all looks like great stuff, so I think it's not necessarily saying, I don't think this is important, it's just prioritizing, and you know what I mean? And just in terms of language, I know it might be hard to say, well, I really like this one, I'm going to put it a little lower. It doesn't mean you don't care about it.
That's what almost everybody said during the Q sort.
Yeah, okay.
Right. But again, I say, if we're trying to define ourselves, can't go in there with 24 cards,
right.
And so we're not necessarily, one of the things I've changed sort of in my thinking about this is the things on the bottom are not anti-values, they're not things we're against, but they're things that we wouldn't necessarily identify as our core educational values.
Mm-hmm.
Yes?
Actually, I think her hand was up.
Oh, sorry.
Whoever did this made an assessment that, for instance, character included kindness and empathy. But as a first grade teacher, when I saw that up there, I immediately put kindness and empathy under community.
Mm.
Because in school, we spend a lot of time building community in the classroom, and we talk a lot about kindness and empathy and respecting others. And So to me, you know, right away, I'm not sure that community is out of there.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So.
Okay. So that's the discussion we're having tonight. Mm-hmm. That's the feedback we need.
I very much agree with Mary in terms of the overarching themes that you seem to have reached.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Maybe it could be modified or thought about more or discussed.
That's what the goal of tonight is.
I was going to say something similar, which is that I actually see the bully prevention or the avoiding substance abuse as connected to engagement in community and connection and those qualities that you're talking around about, sort of supporting positive communities, helping people feel engaged in their community, developing empathy, et cetera, they can also address the concerns that showed up on the students' sorts around preventing bullying. Does that make sense? So that I see them kind of in a bucket together, even if that's not how students sorted.
So we're going to discuss that in small groups. I don't want to declare we have consensus yet, but it seems like there's a will, at least in some parts of the room, to try to advocate for bringing community back in, even on the basis of the student sorts. So that would be important in sort of the final analysis of this. So next steps are to seek consensus, and we have a protocol for that. So I'm going to turn it back over to my colleagues from CES to talk about how the next part of the night works.
We have some guiding questions, open-ended questions, based on what you've just seen that you're going to be responding to. And then Catherine and I will just take some notes while that's happening. So if we have one group here, if this is the group of seven, we'll take the group of eight and move back that way.
So the first question, when you consider the higher priorities selected, do they resonate with you? They align with your experiences relative to your contact with youth in Northampton?
I would say yes. In terms of what? Being good goals for them?
Well, does it seem like, I think what this means is...
In terms of what we want out of our school, from
our
schools?
Yeah, does it... When you look at this, do you say, oh yeah, that's really how I feel? Or do you say, well, you know, I would have really wanted X to be in there. I mean, does it...
Well, it goes back to, I don't have the whole list, so I can't really remember everything that I prioritized, but it doesn't really resonate with what I think I prioritize.
Yeah, so
also, seeing it this way is very confusing.
It is, I agree.
So if we had a graph which showed, like, you know, all of them are relative to one another, it'd be much more meaningful to make that assessment. Like, but the way this is shown, I can't visualize or interpret anything.
Right.
But these are the priorities that most people came up with. So, I mean, going with that, I think the first, or, no, those are the lower.
These are the lower.
Those are the lower ones.
Yeah,
okay.
So here's the higher ones.
So, I mean, I think your question, not doing this sort, was really important, that I don't think the lower ones mean that those weren't important to people or that they were against them, just that you had to choose which was the most important. So I wouldn't focus so much on what's low.
And also so many of them were repetitive.
That's what I'm
saying.
Yeah.
So very repetitive,
confusing.
That I found myself prioritizing one that meant the same thing as one that I put that one very high, and I put the one that meant the same thing low because I thought, what, we wouldn't want to be redundant.
Yeah, right.
And I found the repetitiveness of this, of the items, to be somewhat discrediting,
mm-hmm.
in terms of, because I know when you had to sort, like, I mean, yes, you could sort of overweight and put all the ones that meant the same thing at the front, I guess, but I found myself doing the opposite.
Yeah, I didn't do that.
Yeah. Where, how were they developed, these?
Well, so all I know really is what I just heard him say. And what I heard him say, what I understood him to say, is that at some school events, they had people write on a card the answer to the question, what should the Northampton schools be doing, or complete this sentence. And then from those 300 notes, somebody grouped them into these categories.
Because I really agree with what you're saying, that I feel like a lot of the language is very overlapping and similar. Like I,
yeah.
So, it, yeah, it's right. almost but like it, sh- it could have been simplified and kind of clarified.
So,
yeah, I would have found this very hard to do.
Around the cards, we did have a process of sort of proving the cards. We have the group at UMass that did the analysis got the first, actually one of them helped me break down the 300 to the 24, I think it was. And then we sent those sort of draft statements to people at UMass and asked them, try these around, see if people can discriminate what they mean. And then we got feedback, a lot of the statements were unclear, a lot of them were like duplications. And so we rewrote them to try to reduce the number of cards that were different but sounded the same, you know what I mean? So then it was when we got that final set that we asked people to sort. And a lot of them still were close because they were what people put in the bucket, but they were written, and a number of them were so many times, and they were written in different ways that we didn't think we wanted to introduce bias by saying, oh no, it's all the same thing. Mm-hmm. You know, for the people who wrote them, we thought they might have meant something different.
My reaction is that when I look at the top two and I think about my own kids, if I had to have two things that I would want them to get out of their school experience, honestly, I feel like those totally resonate for me. I want my kids to be like, figure out who they are and like what they're good at and what their interests are and what sort of fires them up, and I want them to be nice people. So I totally think for me as a parent, those top values absolutely resonate for me in goals I would have for my kids at school.
And as a teacher, probably weights as well, you
know, putting the kind of look at. So I guess my concern is reading through all of those, it says reach their potential, develop their interests, learn how to learn, love to learn, and that doesn't character does not summarize that for me.
I think he was calling that curiosity.
Or curiosity. Yeah, curiosity. It's curiosity does not summarize that for me.
It's more than curiosity.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so that curiosity feels empty.
Can you think of a better word than curiosity? Can anyone? Passion.
Do you think that looks a little better? But it's passion plus hard work.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I know some of the Q sorts had the word challenge in them, but it's odd. Those are oddly missing
and rigor,
here, in my opinion. I don't know if that's a bad word, you know, to some people.
Right, those must have been in the middle because they weren't in the high and
or low. Yeah, yeah.
It was something.
And you could argue, we could argue all night long that that is embodied in some of these, right. You know, strongly. But it seems odd that the word doesn't appear.
Well, rigorous was there.
Rigorous.
Right.
Was some,
yeah.
Right. Some,
yeah.
Yes. And that's what I would think. Challenge.
Yeah, it kind of get at a little bit in a backward way with a lot of people didn't rank high, protecting them from stress of grades and assessments.
But there was another one that must have ended up in the middle.
Yeah.
Can we go back to he had the original list.
Yeah, let's see if we can go back to the original list.
Ta-da.
Ta-da.
Okay.
So be challenged by rigorous curriculum. Mm-hmm.
So that was neither high nor low. Right.
But again, I mean, yes. I would argue that that is
part of.
Well, I would argue that
reaching the potential.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I would definitely say that. But I would also say that that puts the word challenged with the, you know, if you could, the word rigor takes the word challenge and gives it a negative connotation, in my opinion. So I don't know. I mean, I don't know who rewrote these. You know, maybe there's all kinds of professional expertise there, but it seems very random to me.
Well, I mean, I guess it sounds like they worked with some folks at UMass on doing this. And people who understand all of that statistical stuff better than I did. I caught some of what he was saying, especially when we went back and talked about it some more, but the first time through, I thought, I have no idea
what that is. I think reaching your potential.
It includes that.
It does include that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would say that. And then discovering their interests, I think that's really very personal.
Yeah.
But is there one really word you were sort of asking?
You were asking for one word, and the word that comes to my mind is it like, you know, should challenge. Yeah, but again, it seems like that's a bad word, so I don't know.
I feel like the part that's lost in the character in the word curiosity is the finding of self, which I think is really a big part of that top goal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I'm, you know.
Character. It's more than character.
It's more than curiosity, right? Curiosity is the word that he was using to describe this, and it's about self-knowledge, too.
Curiosity is more about the external world, isn't it? Mm-hmm. How things work and why things work, and that's good, but you're right, it doesn't encompass inward reflection.
It doesn't speak to reaching your potential, really. Uh-huh.
Can I just ask, so this study, this Q sort was done, which gave a lot of good information and was analyzed, statistically analyzed, all that. And so our role now is to take that information, like what are we trying to do here as a group?
Help him come up with a kind of statement or a structure with which this can be...
Because I guess I just feel a little like that's a huge leap from all that amount, that many people giving input and it being ranked and then having a small group of people sort out this last piece. Do you know what I'm saying?
He already spent a lot of time analyzing. He presented what he thought those represented, the major top ideas represented. And that's what he said today was character, curiosity,
right, but I'm just saying
he wants to see if we agree or if we disagree.
He's basically trying to summarize
what we think.
Right, I guess I'm saying if you look at all this, I feel a little uncomfortable in summarizing it.
I totally agree
because
with you. I think
it's a lot going on
trying to put
here.
It in three C's.
Oh, yeah.
It's
hard.
It's like what? Well, I don't know what the point of that.
Yeah, what is the point?
Right. How about if we just left it with?
What is the point?
Left it with the top two. And then, as the core values,
or just like a Bill of Rights, like top.
Yeah,
10.
Does it have to be
top 10?
Yeah, does it have to be
taking away of some that. Redundancy?
Yeah,
you know.
Can we go back to the slide that showed the priorities? Sorry.
Sure. I think trying to make it the three C's is too simple.
Yeah, it's a little just like catchy without the.
Too catchy.
Here are the highest priorities, and let me know if you want to see the student ones.
Yeah.
Too simple.
Right.
Can we see the slide with the three C's on it?
Yeah.
There.
That's it. Yeah. Oh, it'd be nice to have three.
Yeah, it kind of sounds like someone was trying to boil things down even more.
Make it simple.
Right. Yeah, just
right.
Simple.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Or
we could have four C's.
At least three. I'm trying to remember, since I'm on the school committee and so is Rebecca, and we would have to at some point vote to do something with this. What is the end purpose?
Yeah,
is this going to be sort of the mission for the district? John, can you weigh in?
I think it's a value statement.
Okay.
Slightly different than mission,
uh-huh.
But sort of a guiding star when the committee has tough choices to make about what gets funded and what doesn't get funded, or what policy gets approved or disapproved. If there are a few bedrock principles that it can go back to help it think through some of the issues.
I think that trying to compress it into three things or two things, generalizing it, is oversimplifying. I think to just have a list of 10, taking out some redundancy among them, you know, and maybe changing the wording to something that, you know, you guys would think gets at it more, would suffice. I think to try to do this is changing it too much from the nature of what the study was.
So you're thinking maybe just list all of those things that are up there.
Again, there's a lot of redundancy there. So, like, how do you, you know, those, like the love of learning comes up three times at the top. So couldn't that just be one? And maybe that should be first, since it was three items that all came up towards the top. That's what I mean. So, yeah, just prioritize them based on
how they.
But aren't these the things that were?
Well, but this is trying to group them, and the prioritization is lost.
Take the words out of character, curiosity, and community, and just list the things that are there, as opposed to putting them into a little,
into
a category.
Yeah. Right.
Just have them as standing.
Sure,
statements.
That's basically what I'm saying, except that we would prioritize them by how they appeared in the Q sort, not necessarily by how they group together under larger categories like these.
Right,
that's all I'm saying.
And kind of looking to, like you're saying, is this one really pretty redundant? So we know it's up here, but was there something else over here that maybe we want to look at before we don't have it on the top 10. You know what I mean? I understand we have to go by that. But you know what I mean? Like, I think you're right. A lot of it's redundant, so it's like, okay, we know these are here. But like, I guess an example for me is like healthy meals. Okay, if that doesn't show at the top, and then healthy meals is, you know, never kind of discussed because it's not. And I realize I'm kind of, but it's like healthy meals are important. And I'm not saying you can have everything on the list, but I'm just a little worried that if you kind of do it that way, that we keep just saying, oh, nobody thought that was important. I don't know. It's just,
also, do you?
It did at least come, it was one of the 24.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah, so it made that. Right. So that's a lot of people saying it's writing it down, right?
Right. It was just one or two people.
Yeah.
We did something similar to this at the high school with the NEASC committee, which is the accreditation process that we have to go through every 10 years. And I was on the committee to develop the core values. And we did a very similar process where we asked the students, the parents, the teachers, the community members, anybody could have input to what we value at the high school. And then we took all of that information, the committee that I was working on, and we looked at what the parents valued, and we looked at what the students valued, and they were different. It was very interesting information, and we created our core values for the school. And those core values of the school are really what are supposed to be guiding us into the decisions that we make. And I think that's really what this is mirroring, that you know what those things are that you value, and then policy decisions, budget decisions, curriculum decisions, you go back to that core document, and that's what everybody's had input in. So I think that's really what this is trying to mimic in a way.
Mm-hmm.
Which I think is really, really helpful and really important.
Mm-hmm.
Let's move on to some of the other questions. So community emerged as a theme for staff and parents, but not for students. Do you think it should be included as one of the core values?
Of course.
Well,
I think it's funny that that's even a question, actually.
Mm.
But I think worrying about bullying is all about community.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Am I safe here?
Yeah.
That's what that asks.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's another piece of language. It's using different language. What did they mean by when they said no bullying?
Right.
Yeah. They probably meant community, but they didn't. That word didn't ring for them, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because we do have a definition of community, social skills here, and it seems like that ties into
it's social.
Like,
definitely.
Let's go down and look at what the students did say. So these are the highest things, the very highest, develop social skills, and then also the hands-on learning.
I love that is something that the kids said.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I think that's
which one?
The hands-on learning experiences.
What do you think that means to kids? I don't know.
I think that means they don't want to sit in a room all day listening to somebody talking to them all day.
Or watching a movie.
They want to do things.
So great that the kids are saying, we want to be involved actively in the stuff we're learning. Like, I'm thrilled that came out.
Me too.
Either that or it means that they aren't getting enough of that already.
Right.
Which is...
And it was ranked higher by the kids than the parents and teachers.
Yes.
Well, it's interesting that they seem to have picked more kind of very specific survey actions.
Yeah.
And parents and teachers picked more kind of overarching
themes,
right? Like prevent bullying and, as you know, we said, comparing it, you know, or how it's sort of equating it to, you know, developing kindness and empathy and social skills. Like, that's sort of the, to me, that was more the umbrella. Mm-hmm. Prevent bullying, avoid substance abuse, have hands-on learning. Those are, you know, develop a love of learning, a passion and interest.
That's
more
like
umbrella.
The developmental thing.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. From their perspective.
Right.
Right.
Well, I mean, you could argue that having hands-on learning leads to a love of learning.
Right. That's
I
my
mean,
point. Is
that's
it's
how,
all very...
you know, they're saying, this is how I want to learn.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So if we help them learn that way, they're going to love learning mm-hmm. rather than sitting being lectured to.
Right.
So mm-hmm. it, again, I think it's just, it's sort of so interwoven, all of this.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't. You can't say it's something different from what we're saying.
Yeah, and I think that that was captured for the curiosity. I think you can definitely say that it goes into curiosity.
Hands-on learning experiences.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So when you think of that, the hands-on learning experience is like, you know, as an educator, that's just basic, you know, best practices
mm-hmm.
that we ought to be following all the time,
yeah.
just like washing our hands correctly or something
mm-hmm.
like that. And it's I think of it less as a core value than a best practice.
I don't necessarily disagree with you on that, but I think you're also accurate in saying it doesn't happen enough.
Yeah.
And that's why it's coming
up.
Sort of
for kids,
yeah.
Well, the whole impact of the standardized testing is,
sure.
I think,
right.
huge
yeah.
with this. I mean, I'm seeing it in my daughter's classes. Yes.
I mean, there are a lot of schools that meet the standardized tests and do a lot of really active
mm-hmm.
teaching, so it can have more to do with teacher training and the methods
mm-hmm.
that they're using and,
mm-hmm.
and that kind of thing. So I don't think they're necessarily
okay.
mutually exclusive.
But maybe more, even more important to balance what you're saying.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, are we going till 8:30 with the discussion, or are we going to come back and debrief as a group? What's
I
the
think
question?
We should debrief by 8:30.
Okay, but I'm wondering, how long do we have for this discussion?
I'd say we want to leave the last 15 minutes for the group
okay.
to come back
so,
together.
So about 12, 14 more minutes,
yeah.
and then we'll come back to you.
Okay, great.
So the students talked about leisure and physical health and emotional well-being more so than the adults. And, you know, you can quibble with the categories things are in, but in general, that showed up more frequently for the students than for the parents and the staff. So do you think, given that either of those two themes, or both, should be in the core values?
I think they should. I mean, I kind of feel like they're the ones living it,
right.
not us.
right?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, shouldn't they be having a big impact on it? You know, I know for my daughter, it's a lot of sitting and being lectured to. There's very few physical breaks, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Lunch is not too great. Like, I just think there's
yeah.
things they're living every day that, like,
right.
honestly, as an adult, if I were sitting there, I don't think I'd be too happy. You know? So I think there should definitely be.
I mean, athletics wasn't in the high in the top seven for students.
That was elementary.
Yeah.
One we think is sort of a self-actualization, growth mindset, curiosity.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
All right. Now, of the remainder in the parent and staff high ranking, we've got developing kindness, respecting and appreciating diversity, developing social skills, and becoming aware of matters of global concern. You know, I think all of those have to do with community.
You think those are all connected with community?
Respecting and appreciating diversity?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Absolutely. That's so impacts community.
Mm-hmm.
And develop kindness and empathy and compassion.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we
We do so much work with that in the elementary schools in terms of having children get along with each other.
Sure. And in that broader context,
building that community. Not just classroom community, but school community and the greater, yeah.
Yep, no, I can see where that you make a good case for many of those attributes to be, again, not only in the individual, within the school, outside of the school, and in the broader community. So I think you're right that you could.
So I think there's actually two buckets.
Yep.
Okay.
Well, for the parent and teacher.
With the community.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Feel safe in your community.
The community emerged more so for the parents and staff in those higher rankings, less so for the students. Well, but what I'm hearing is that you also think it should be included, you know, as in that broad context, although the students may have ranked it a little bit lower than parents and staff did.
Well, but the students put prevent bullying and develop social skills at the very top of theirs.
Mm-hmm. And
those could be interpreted as community.
You could reinterpret those as community. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay.
I really like to know what the two buckets are called.
You know, one's sort of the individual, and one's the individual in society, and one's the individual in the community. And one's the community.
That's an interesting way of looking at it. Yeah,
it's true.
More of that sort of
in
individual.
In a very simplistic way.
And then the
broader
social and community context. And with community also being defined as a school community.
Yes, Watson.
Other thoughts on how, you know, thinking of those two buckets in that way, again, based on what you've grouped, what parents and staff ranked highly, what students ranked highly.
One looking in and the other looking out.
Sort of an inward, outward kind of thing. Yeah. Okay.
For some reason, that seems like a Beatles song.
Other ways of thinking about those buckets, other labels, other terms that might resonate. Again, we'll just capture as many as we can, and it'd be interesting to see if, you know, what the other group. They may be having some of the same.
If there's a way to connect individuals who are part of a community somehow, connecting that, I need more time to think about what that might sound like or look like. But I mean, we're developing individuals to be members of a community, or
You want the children to be responsible for themselves,
right?
But then also,
it really makes sense to have that really nice balance, the duality of the two.
Right,
the individual,
individual.
And you need the individual to be able to have the interactions with the other individuals, and that's when you start to add in these other characteristics.
Right. I mean, the collaborative piece of learning is so critical. I mean, you can't have just the individual growth without having the community. You're not going to learn any. You're not going to learn a whole lot. So I don't know how you would label them in a catchy way.
Being our best selves.
Being too cheesy. I don't know. I want a thesaurus. We're in a library, right?
That's what I'm trying to
do. I know. She's been pulling up with thesaurus, too.
Oh, really?
Thirst for knowledge?
You know, different ways to think about that individual. I think you've hit on something with respect to how some of these high priorities could be looked at in that individual versus in conjunction with that broader collective community. I wrote down collaboration. I heard that word. I heard the duality of the individual attributes and strivings, along with how does that fit with a more social, community, collective kind of context too.
It's like there's the individual and the other and others, but I don't want to think of it in terms of others. I don't like that.
Community is a wonderful.
You could do developing one's own abilities and then sharing that with the community.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Because isn't
but
that
you
what
also
you
develop your abilities
to
part
function
of,
within it.
Well, not just that, but. But
many times you develop your abilities with the community. The community helps you develop your abilities. That's why we do all sorts of cooperative learning and everything else.
Self-learning, community learning, or as the link?
But you're learning within the community. Mm-hmm. I mean, you need the community to be able to learn.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, then can it just be student development and community development? Because we're developing both.
Students
and members of
community. Developing self, developing
community. You didn't jump on that, Mary.
No, I'm thinking about it.
When I think about development, I think about
the accessibility. I don't work in the Twitter world. I really think about things ahead of time.
Personalized? Could that somehow fit for the individual?
Personal versus the, not versus
what we're looking up here.
So personal, individual.
I'm not connecting to the internet here.
Personalized, community learning.
Community learning, personalized, and community. Other terms for that broader social.
Yeah, I usually have no problem at least.
Social context. I also
look
just.
That.
Oh, there we go.
Look at that.
It's
in there.
I just want a quick time check as well. We have just a couple more minutes before we're going to go back in to the large group.
I need to leave when we go back to the large group.
Great, thank you for letting us know. Maybe as you're looking through that and thinking about, again, additional terms that might be applicable to that individual and the community
The individual piece is the child and the student as the learner.
It's like the internal, external.
Yeah, that's what you were saying, inward, outward, internal.
You can't really separate those.
It's hard to separate them. I mean, you can't learn in a vacuum.
You can join those without, like, a conjoining word, like the internal something and the external something, and then and then it shows that linkage.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And almost sort of, sometimes folks think of concentric circles, too. You've got that center and that.
And then the number 17, develop social skills and improve mental or emotional well-being. That really goes in both.
Right. Character and community.
It's not character. It's the self-actualization
thing. Right.
This goes
confidence,
2 and 1.
Confidence can also be both, because you're developing confidence to work with yourself and developing confidence with
you could, although it has to start with yourself, sort of.
It's true. Yeah.
But I think that one, number 17, developing social skills and improving mental and emotional well-being, are really in both buckets.
And that sort of relates to just the last question that we wanted to try to pose. What I'm hearing is that, you know, again, from the results, the emotional well-being, leisure, and physical health were themes that students ranked a little higher, less so for parents. But I'm hearing that there's a sense that those should be included. In other words, you feel like that should be part of it, particularly the emotional well-being piece, as has been mentioned, as both as part of social skills as well as individual.
Well, and we haven't really touched on the fact that the students did rank extracurricular activities or co-curricular activities more highly, but that to me is community also. If you're talking about teams, and a team, a band, a chorus, those could all be community.
Well, the fifth graders ranked them higher.
Yeah, it wasn't in the overall
school
rankings, but it was in the second.
There's the fifth graders.
But we
graders.
Just haven't discussed it.
Yeah.
So I think that.
Well, and I also wonder, because there's less opportunities in the elementary schools, for co-curricular, extracurricular activity, that is there. Oh, but they hear about their friends that have gone on to JFK or high school, and that they want some of that. And so I wonder if it's about wanting what they don't have, and then when you get into those secondary schools, you have those opportunities that maybe weren't there previously.
Well, I think it's interesting that the the elementary student rankings. Let's see.
The athletics, the recreation,
all of that is a little higher too.
Right, that's why I'm wondering, because they don't have
that, many of them don't have that resource.
Well, we had an interesting, we have an interesting thing that happens at Jackson Street. Every year, Gwen invites the high school seniors who went to Jackson Street to come back.
That's cool.
At the graduation. And she asked them to say what their favorite memory was and where they're going. And their favorite memory, almost always, the vast majority of children, their favorite memory is something to do with physical or the outdoors. Mm-hmm. It's either PE or the playground or nature's classroom or, it's like huge.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's partly goes in with the hands-on learning, but it partly goes into recreation. Mm-hmm. But that physical piece, that outdoor piece, is huge for the kids.
Great. I guess we'll spend a few minutes just sort of giving you a little bit of an idea of what each group came up with, and just also to let you know that Catherine and I will be writing up both of our groups, and then also combining information with next week's group. So remember that this is just part one of two. I guess to try to summarize, and I'm certainly other folks can chime in, our group, we looked at those themes that emerged across all of those, the parents, the staff, as well as students. And we spent some time really thinking about how those buckets could be re-looked at and redefined. So the character, curiosity, and community buckets that were initially laid out, lots of good conversation about what kinds of things might be in more than one bucket, what was the role of social skills, emotional development, diversity, how did that fit not only with individual character but also the larger community, and then also started talking about sort of individual attributes, characteristics, self-confidence, growth, learning, those kinds of things on an individual level, but then also on that broader social and community level. We also spent some time thinking about how those buckets might be redefined and even some additional language. And John had said, too, that one of the points was let's make them clear and understandable for everyone, but they may also, other terminology might be worth taking a look at. I think those were the major themes that came out of the group that was there. I'll let Catherine talk about her group. It'd be interesting to see if some of the same things came out.
Absolutely. I'd say some of the same things came out. I think there was pushback in this group, not against the rankings, the 24 things, but against the way they were summarized in summed up here, and people feeling like some stuff was glossed over a little too much. Some stuff could have been in other categories that wasn't. Some things that seemed really high coming out of the rankings seemed to be minimized here. So a thought was, why are we even doing themes? Why not just talk about the top ranked, the top three, or the top five, or however many things? Does it really need to be boiled down into themes? Should we just go with the statements that the people actually looked at and sorted? That was one question that came out of it. And then some additional conversations around where different things could go and what words could be included in these themes to highlight some of the things that seem to be coming out of the rankings more strongly. Anything you would add to that?
Or just, having more specific listing. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily cutting off at five and then you still don't have the rest in any discussions, but trying to not sort of group and simplify as much, but have a clear list that, and then looking at, like we talked a lot about how some things just seem to overlap a lot, like developing empathy and compassion overlaps a lot with anti-bullying, a lot of the language, there are a lot of things that are really the same.
Something else that came out too is honoring all of the 24 original statements, because they at least, those things at least got enough support to make it into the sort. And so the ones that wound up on the bottom, they were not as prioritized, but maybe someone somewhere should still be aware of them. The lunch issue is important enough to enough people that it came out in the sort, if not at the top of the sort.
We were had sort of a different take than I think you did in terms of actually felt like everything could basically be categorized in two buckets, like either the individual child as a learner, you know, and taking risks and being curious and developing a level of learning and, you know, having the self-confidence to do all those things. And then the child within the community. So we actually felt like there were two big buckets. More individual and community, basically.
I would add to that, too, that I think that group, you know, I wrote down a lot of additional terms that I think capture those buckets, but also maybe more fully, you know, sort of exemplify or illustrate what the group was thinking about in those buckets. So that will capture that in the notes as well.
Can you talk to about, you said this pretty much, but the importance of what the students ranked up there, mm-hmm. and making sure we really include that and prioritize it, because they're the ones that are living it every day. I mean, we are perhaps older and wiser, but, you know, really having it be very much directed by them, what they're mm-hmm. saying.
For example, for anti-bullying to come to the top.
Mm-hmm. Right, but in that regard,
a pretty strong statement.
We only have representation by children from the fifth grade up, which means you have no representation of the younger children who may have a different view and come at it from a different place than fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth to 12th. Like as a first grade teacher, some things immediately jumped out to me that might not have jumped out to a teacher at the high school. Because of how we teach children and what emphases we place in K-1, 2, 3, which has a huge amount to do with community and social skills and, respect and development and empathy and compassion, all of that. That's a huge component, as well as self-confidence and emotional well-being and all of that. You know, by the time they're in fifth grade, a lot of that is in place. They still have a lot of learning to do, but there's so much that they need to grow in those areas when they're young.
I would argue it's ongoing.
Yeah, I mean,
that's right. It's doing a lot of work.
Right.
I wish a lot of elementary school stuff was still going through high school in a lot of ways. I also think it's a little tricky when developmentally you've got a 6-year-old and a
17-year-old. Yeah.
But I mean, it's hard to kind of include because it's just, there's it's such different stages.
Right.
Yeah.
But they were all there. I mean, those fifth graders definitely remember being the younger kids.
Mm-hmm.
And they take that.
So I think we have two opposite solutions. One, more buckets. Maybe no buckets, maybe just put all the statements in two buckets. We do have one more meeting, maybe it'll clarify more between now and then. What I would invite is, as you're thinking about this driving home or in the middle of the night, if you get a brainstorm and you just see the right way to sort of characterize this data, email me. Another thought that I have is, maybe this should have a short form and a long form. Maybe we have like a shorthand version of what the core values are, but then a longer text that explains what that means. See some nodding heads around that. So maybe we'll do that. I really appreciate your coming out tonight to contribute to this, because the more people who can provide feedback and their perspectives, the better this final statement will be, which I hope will be around for a long time. So if you have friends who couldn't make it tonight, or didn't want to make it tonight, tell them they made a mistake. Tell them there's one more next Tuesday. And please invite them to show up.
Same place, right down here?
Same place, same time.
Thank you very much, everyone. Appreciate your input and your grappling with these issues.
Yeah.